Following the disaster at the Battle of Hlobane in March 1879, the forces of Colonel Evelyn Wood prepared to receive an attack by the entire Zulu army. The British forces under Colonel Wood had faced some of the leading sections of the Zulu force, but had not encountered the entire army. Soon after dawn the next day, the Transvaal Rangers rode out to locate the Zulu. The Transvaal Rangers consisted of approximately 60 European volunteers, supported by 148 men of the Transvaal Mounted Rifles. The Rangers were successful in locating the Zulu, discovering their entire army. Cetshwayo, the king of the Zulus, had responded to pleas from the Abakulusi, a native tribe of the area, for aid against the raids of Wood's troops by ordering the main Zulu army to help them.
Yes, sir.
By midday, the Rangers had returned with the news that the Impi was on the move and was to attack Kambula at noon. Wood also now received information that the Impi was nearly 21,000 men strong, consisting of regiments that had already defeated the British at the Battle of Isandlwana and other battles. Many of the Zulus were armed with rifles taken from the British dead at these battles. Shortly after this, the Zulu Impi was sighted 8 kilometers away from Wood's camp across the plain, coming on due westwards in five columns. The warriors of the Impi had not eaten for 3 days. In the meantime, Wood had created defences on Kambula, which consisted of a hexagonal lager formed with wagons that were tightly locked together. 4 7-pounder guns were positioned between the redoubt and the lager to cover the northern approaches. 2 more guns in the redoubt covered the northeast. The gunners had been told that if the Zulus got in close, they were to abandon their guns outside the lager. Wood's force mustered 121 Royal Artillery and Royal Engineers, 1,238 infantry, and 638 mounted men. With headquarters staff, it totaled 2,000 men. Confident that the defences could be manned within a minute and a half of an alarm being sounded, Wood was not fearing a surprise attack and allowed his men to eat breakfast.
Yes, sir.
Midday, on the 29th of March, 1879, the British troops took up their battle stations. As the troops moved to their posts, they could see the Zulu right horn, circling north out of British artillery range before halting northwest of the camp. Lieutenant Colonel Redvers Henry Buller was ordered with his mounted troops to sting the right horn into a premature attack. The men rode out to within range of the massed Zulus, dismounted at a few hundred yards, and fired one volley. The effect was instantaneous. ...11,000 Zulus sprang up and swarmed forward. The British troops fled back with the Zulus on their tail. As the mounted troops retreated to the British camp, the artillery opened fire to cover their retreat.
All right then.
As soon as the horsemen had reached Kambula and cleared the field of fire and the Zulus came within range, the British infantry opened fire. buoyed by a belief that witch doctors' potions had made them immune to bullets, they threw themselves recklessly at the barricades. They were mown down by shrapnel fire and volleys from the infantry defending the lager's south face. Wood was eager to get involved in the battle and had to be restrained by his officers when he attempted to go to the aid of a wounded trooper who had been shot outside the redoubt. A small number of Zulus managed to burst into the lager. These Zulus were eventually repelled with bayonets, while the bulk of the advance was held at bay by the steady British volley fire and artillery. Zulus with rifles climbed to the rim of the ravine nearby and began firing at the defenders in the cattle kraal, forcing their withdrawal into the redoubt. The Zulus took control of the kraal until Wood ordered two companies of the 90th Light Infantry to retake it with a bayonet charge. Close range, the gunners bombarded the Zulu infantry with case shot, creating a killing zone in front of the lager. The Zulus charged again and again with unwavering courage, but the head of each charge was shot away. At about 5:30 p.m., the Zulus began to retire from the battlefield. In 4 hours, the British had fired 138,000 rounds and 1,077 shells. As soon as the Zulus began to move eastwards, Woods ordered Buller to pursue the Zulu with his 600 horses. Captain Cecil Darcy of the Frontier Light Horse told his troopers to take no prisoners and told them, "No quarter, boys, and remember yesterday." Referring to the action at Hlobane, where his men had suffered severely, the Frontier Light Horse singled out the Aba Kulusi, chasing them as far as Hlobane and extracting a savage revenge for their comrades killed the day before. Following the cavalry, the British infantry and African auxiliaries combed the field, killing any wounded or hiding Zulus. Around 6:30 p.m., as dusk fell, a mist rose around the Zungin Mountains, stopping the pursuit. By the end of the battle, the British had suffered around 75 casualties, and the Zulus had suffered between 1,000 and 2,000 casualties. Kambula was the decisive battle of the war. It nullified the Zulu victory at Isandlwana and weakened the Zulu kingdom severely. The British demonstrated that Shield and Assegai were no match for an entrenched force with artillery and the Martini Henry rifle. Never again would an Impi fight against a prepared position with the ferocity and resolution displayed at Kambula. The Zulu commander, Meniamana, tried to get the regiments to return to Ulundi, but many warriors simply went home. The shock of the defeat contributed to a weakening of the Zulu resolve to maintain armed resistance to the British invasion. After the final defeat at the Battle of Ulundi on the 4th of July, King Cetewayo fled from his capital and hid in the Nkandla forest. He was eventually discovered, arrested, and banished to Robben Island in Table Bay, where he learnt that his kingdom was being carved up and awarded to chiefs who opposed his Usutu faction.